get our sisters and brothers on the streets of Washington saying that we are everywhere, we are together, we're gay, we're proud, we're strong, and this year is the year.
We cannot have people come to this country on visas. We are kicked by police. We have no employment rights. You can be put in jail for holding hands with your lovers in practically half the states of the United States.
It's time we recognize that this is a national issue. It has got national support.
We know politicians talk out of both sides of their mouths. And we want to know what they're going to do this year, not next year with promises.
We are going to ensure them of their civil rights and of their human rights because we are going to save our children.
In 1969, outside the Stonewall Bar in New York City, for the first time in America, gay men and women demonstrated in the streets for their human rights. In the 10 years since the Stonewall riots, lesbians and gay men have fought to end the ignorance and discrimination surrounding homosexuality. But many Americans still oppose this effort, some with a Bible, others with violence. And this is what brings hundreds of thousands of gay men and women to the mall today in Washington, D.C. They've come from all across the nation, and many from abroad, to march from the Capitol building, march up Pennsylvania Avenue to the White House, and finally turning south to gather here by the Washington Monument. And many more gay men and women who cannot be with us in Washington today will be able to hear the voices of gay liberation in this national broadcast. And now, from the Washington Monument in our nation's capital, we bring you the rally at the National March on Washington for Lesbian and Gay Rights.
And welcome to the rally. I'm Moira Rankin from the Sophie's Parlor Media Collective, broadcast here in Washington, D.C. on WPFW.
I'm Lucia Chappell from KPFK in Los Angeles, the Gay Radio Collective.
And I'm Greg Gordon from KPFK, the Gay Radio Collective. The official police estimate of the crowd in the march is 250,000, a quarter of a million. We've just heard from Eleanor Schmiel, the president of the National Organization for Women, and Ray Hill from Houston, Texas, is now talking. The crowd is still coming in from the march area. This is
Washington, D.C., between Constitution Avenue and Pennsylvania Avenue is absolutely frozen. Traffic is totally tied up. Gay people here in Washington from across the nation are making their demands known in very real, concrete ways.
We are not yet certain who the next speaker will be, but let us take you now to the stage and Ray Hill, one of the national coordinators.
Yesterday, Robin Tyler produced and emceed the first largest national gay lesbian concert. 10,000 people here on the campus ground. She also, in April of 1978 in St. Paul, Minnesota, originally was the first person to call for a national march on Washington. Comet, activist, radical feminist, dyke. Robin Tyler.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's great to know that we have outdrawn the Pope. Then we're crooked, but if we're gay, then morose.
It's called sharing. But when we show them the picture of our lovers, it's called flaunting. When we feel it's time that we shared. I want those television cameras out there to turn around and focus on one of the largest demonstrations in the history of this country. Look at that crowd. Focus on that crowd.
Lesbian feminist comic Robin Tyler leading the crowd in the chant, "We Are Everywhere." And we are live broadcasting to such cities as Boston, Massachusetts, New York City, Buffalo, New York, Storrs, Connecticut, San Francisco, California, and many more stations.
We are everywhere!
The next people to speak will be from Parents and Friends of Gays. There will be Robert Ashworth.
We are
and Adelle Starr.
It is my pleasure to introduce now a man who has given and dedicated his life to gay and lesbian rights, who is a feminist, who is my brother, and the greatest thing I can say about this gentleman is if I were standing in a war in a trench, holding a gun on my enemy, and I needed someone beside me that I trusted would never leave my side and would fight until the death for me, nobody would fight harder or try harder than Troy Perry.
We've come a long way from Dade County, Florida. When we started the fight in Dade County, Florida with Anita Bryant, Anita Bryant announced that she had been talking to God. And God had told her the reason that in California we had such bad weather and droughts was because so many gay males and lesbians lived out there. But I'm here to tell Anita Bryant today, the day she came out against us, it snowed in Miami. I think that's it. About where God's at in this whole thing. I come from an organization where in the last 5 years, 12 of our churches have been arson and burned down to the ground. In one case, our minister and 10 of our church members were burned to death because of oppression, because of arson. When I hear people like Anita Bryant and Jerry Farwell from Lynchburg, Virginia, I think that town is aptly named, it really bothers me. People who claim the name of God, shame on you, you hypocrites. Let me tell you now, you don't know God. You couldn't possibly know God. I'm telling you today as gay men and gay women, as we gather here on the Mall, we can have our victory. We can have our power. We have it already. We don't owe apologies to anyone in America. Not anymore. We're here to let Americans know we're your sons, your daughters. We're not going away. We're here and we're going to have our civil rights no matter what. It's for us. Americans just don't know what to do with us. In San Francisco, California, we had gay rights, demonstrations, riots for the first time, big riots in American history. They didn't know what to do when they saw demonstrators throwing Molotov cocktails and running away in their Gucci shoes. They're just not used to that in this country. I'm telling you, they may talk about liberals in America, but these are the strongest wrists in the world. And we'll have our freedom. We'll have our fight if we continue with our struggle. Thank you.
And that was Richard Ashworth, who was...
That was the Reverend Elder Troy Perry of the Universal Fellowship of Metropolitan Community Churches.
You might be interested to know that these proceedings are being simultaneously broadcast over the Pacifica Network stations and the National Public Radio stations. That is, this is the first national live broadcast on radio in history. We ought to do that more often. Our next speaker from San Francisco is Sky Rose, who is with the Gay Youth Community Organizations in the Bay Area, speaking for the Gay Youth of America. Sky Rose.
Is she listening to PFW? Yeah, 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 it's on the air. The PFW is on the air, yeah. I thought it'd be on here.
It's true that gay young people, that gay people are everywhere, but did anyone notice how small the gay youth contingent was? Did anyone think about it? Is anyone aware of how few gay young people there are here and how many there are in the United States and everywhere? It's also true that there was a very small parents group out there supporting gay young people. And one of the demands of this march is to protect young lesbian and gay males from any laws which discriminate against, oppress, and harass young gay people in their homes, schools, environment, etc. Well, that's a pretty radical demand, because what it would actually mean is eliminating and changing laws that oppress all young people, not just gay young people. It means eliminating status offenses, which are laws which prohibit young people from having or expressing a sexuality, from being able to choose our own friends, from being able to read what literature we... Well, that's not a status offense. But that's something that oppresses young people. Status offenses are laws which prohibit young people from doing anything that adults are allowed to do. It disallows young gay people from going into bars, etc. And I'm sorry, I'm suffering from speaking. I've not had that much speaking experience. I'm really talking just from my own experience. I've been a lesbian since I was 9 years old. At least. And there are lesbians and gay young people of all ages. And that's something that gay adults don't take into consideration a lot. Thank you. At any rate, to go back to the demands of this march, ending the oppression of young gay people would mean ending the oppression of all young people. It means that young people should be able to choose our own home. It means that we should be able to direct our own education. It means that we should be able to get to work from whatever age we feel ready to and support ourselves. It means that we should be able to express our sexuality. It means we should be able to be straight or gay or bisexual and express our sexuality. It means that we have a right to information about gay lifestyles in the curriculum, in our schools, and literature in our libraries. It means that we have to have a right and need to organize ourselves in schools. Young gay people might need to organize and get together in schools in spite of all the violence against us. Young gay people need to organize, and young and older gays need to start integrating us into their community. Okay. Thank you. I hope you take seriously what I've said, as scattered as it's been.
That was Sky Rose from San Francisco speaking for gay youth.
Member of the largest lesbian and gay assembly in history.
Coming up next, we believe, will be Richard Ashworth and Adelle Starr from Parents and Friends of Gays. We obviously do not have the list of speakers and entertainers in the order that they are coming on the stage. Ray Hill from Houston is speaking at this moment.
In the fundraising table, that sounds important. Those of you out there who are not standing behind banners, you need to remember this.
If you are too tall for the person behind you to see, make room, spread out. We've got more area over here. The sound system is good. There's an area back to those trees that we can use. If you're holding Barry banners and you're getting tired, why don't you let folks see? Steve, a blind man from Arizona, was separated from his state contingent. He is behind the stage. Will someone from his state contingent come and be with Steve? Let us not leave this man alone. All right? How many people feel good today? I wish they'd take the roof off of this thing, because you've got the sunshine and we all need it. Our next speakers represent the organization of parents and friends and parents of gays by various names across the country. But speaking will be Adelle Starr from Los Angeles Parents and Friends of Gays, and Dick Ashworth of New York City Parents of Lesbians and Gay Men. Here they are.
Friends of gays, thank our lesbian daughters and gay sons. What? Okay, is this better? I'll start again. Okay. I'm too little. Okay. We parents and friends of gays, we thank our lesbian daughters and gay sons for inviting us here today. We're honored. In this International Year of the Child, we march with our children, we support our children, and we are proud of our gay daughters and sons. All across the United States, there are parents of gays groups. We have a common purpose: to speak out against the oppression and the discrimination that hurt our gay children. We parents say, the time is now to assure and guarantee equal rights for all our children and for all gay children everywhere. Parents of gay groups are busy in the communities. You know that we come from every ethnic group, cultural and economic level, and occupation. We are working in our communities now, opening dialogues that stop at the source, the myths that damage our children and inhibit them from attaining their full human potential. In the United States, one out of every four families has a gay person, a gay family member, and that affects all of us. We know that. We parents work with each other so that families can live honest and open lives, free from guilt. We help one another and our family members to listen, to learn, to understand, and to be free from fear. Together, we and our children challenge the attitudes that destroy, the attitudes that have caused violence, bloodshed, suicide, and even murder. And we say no more! We are silent no longer. We are visible. And believe me, the Senate, the Congress, President Carter, and everybody else is going to hear us. We know better than anyone else that our children are healthy, normal, responsible, and caring human beings. And we will see to it that our lesbian daughters and gay sons remain unmarked and unnamed. You know, no one has a monopoly on religion. We're all God's children. And we love all of our children. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you.
The parents and friends of lesbians and gay men today call upon the silent millions of parents of lesbians and gays to come out of the closet and join us in supporting our children. We can only reach your parents through you. The problem is silence, a silence which has helped the bigots in the persecution of our children. And the answer is speaking out. It's time for parents and friends of gays and lesbians to speak out, to tell the world there's nothing wrong with being homosexual. And it's time for the world to realize that we parents of gays love and are proud of and will support our gay children. We parents want to persuade society that our gay children are not acting out of defiance or self-indulgence. They're being true to their own nature. We want to persuade society that it's not a fling or a phase, that homosexuality is something established at least in infancy, possibly even before birth. You weren't made the way you are by your upbringing. You didn't catch it from associating with other gays. It isn't a disease to be cured. We parents must and want to persuade society that the old stereotypes of homosexuals are false. Our children are fine men and women. And we say to society that the parents and friends of lesbians and gay men will support their children. Thank you.
That was Richard Ashworth of Parents of Lesbians and Gay Men in New York. And now we're going to leave the platform for just a moment to go to our mobile unit with Amy Sands and David Winyard.
Well,
we're out here in a huge crowd, and we found the Alaska contingent. Can you tell us what it's like in Alaska and how you got here, how long it took?
Well, it's like any place I've lived so far. As far as the gay community goes, there are a lot of different factions of it that never seem to be organized enough. But getting organized for the march was really good. We got a lot of people working together very positively, a lot of energy that was excellent. And most of us that came, there are about 35 of us here from Anchorage, Juneau, Fairbanks, and Kodiak that I know of that have flown down. We all saved money ourselves and had benefits to bring us all here.
You pretty isolated out there?
In a way, but you know, no more isolated in our sexuality than we are in anything else.
How did you all get down here for this march?
We flew.
What do you think about this?
Oh, I think this is incredible. This is perfect. It's ideal.
What about that? Did you listen to that Parents of Gays speech?
I caught bits of it when I wasn't spacing out looking at the crowd.
Do you know if your parents are listening and what you'd like them to hear or think about?
I doubt if my mom's listening, but I wish she were. I wish it would matter. You know, I wish it would change the way she feels. I know that she loves me and wants to have it make no difference, and yet I know it does make a difference to her.
Is this a coming out for you?
Well, on media it is, but other than that, I wouldn't go so far as to call it a coming out. I preferred my own.
Okay, and now back to the Pacifica tent with Moira, Greg, and Dusha.
Again, we are broadcasting live across the country. Some of the other cities: Eugene, Oregon; Madison, Wisconsin; Minneapolis, Minnesota; Houston, Texas, and the list goes on. We are at the foot of the reflecting pool between the Lincoln Memorial and the Washington Monument, and the crowd is at least up to, if not beyond, the Washington Monument. Coming up next, I believe, is the group celebration. But first, we will pause 10 seconds to have our local stations identify themselves. This is the station program.
And you're coming right back here to us.
here right in front of the stage, about 50 feet away, in the midst of 250,000 people. We're going to go on to the stage very shortly, where a group called Celebration, which is a gay musical collective, is going to be performing. Right now,
but we can tell there's a great amount of confusion around us. We can see very little of what's going on the platform, and there doesn't seem to be an organized speakers list that we can work with, so we're playing it a lot by ear, as it were.
I think that one of the things that people ought to know is some of the groups that have endorsed this march. There are at least 200 to 250 groups across the country that have endorsed it. They come from a wide spectrum. They include the Actors Equity Association, the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees Local, the American Federation of Teachers, the Americans for Democratic Action, the Buckeye Rainbow Society for the Deaf out in Cleveland, the California Human Rights Association, the Chicago Counseling and Psychotherapy Center, the Detroit Coalition of Black Gays, Dignity, the Greater Gotham Business Council up there in the Big Apple, New York City, the Lutherans Concerned for Gay People in Houston, and the Lutherans out there in New England, the Metropolitan Community Church, the Portland Town Council out in Oregon, the Presbyterians for Gay Concerns, up in New York, the Westchester Women's Coffee House, out in Ann Arbor, the Woman's Space, out there in Michigan. This is only a short list of some of the wide variety of groups that have been sponsoring and endorsing this march today.
All these groups have taken part in this demonstration, which focuses on five specific demands: repeal all anti-lesbian and gay laws, pass a comprehensive lesbian gay rights bill in Congress, issue a presidential executive order banning discrimination based on sexual orientation in the federal government, end discrimination in lesbian mother and gay father child custody cases, and the fifth demand is to protect lesbian and gay youth from laws which are used to discriminate against them.
I believe Celebration is getting set up. Again, as Lucia pointed out, we can't see the stage too clearly. They are ready to go. Let's go back up to the platform and to the rally, the National March on Washington.
How many of you left somebody back home to look at this on the television or hear this on the radio? That must mean that we are in larger numbers than even suspected. The next speaker, from the Gay Asians, Lesbian and Gay Asians, is Michiko Cornell.
Sisters and brothers, I am here to represent the Lesbian and Gay Asian Collective, which was formed at the first National Third World Lesbian and Gay Conference this weekend. I don't know if any non-Asian American lesbian and gay man know how important this moment is. This is the first time in the history of the American Hemisphere that the Asian American lesbians and gay men have joined to form a network of support of, by, and for Asian Americans, lesbian and gay men. I must interject a little comment here. I am being careful to use the phrase Asian American because we are not hyphenated Americans, nor are we always foreign-born women and men from Asia. We have been in this country for over 150 years. We live in Asian America. It's a statement of our experiences and a statement of racism in America. I am awed at this moment and what it can mean for Asian American lesbians and gay men. America has called us the model minority and has claimed that we are 200% Americans. The truth is that because we're less than one half of 1% of the population of this country, and because of the lies that the American media perpetrates against us, we have difficulty in impacting even third world lesbians and gay men. We are called the model minority, the quiet, passive, exotic erects with the slanted cunt to match our slanted eyes, or the small dick to match our small size. but we are not. For years, Asian Americans have organized against our oppression. We have protested and were lynched, deported, and put into concentration camps during World War II. We must not forget that the United States of America has bombed, napalmed, and colonized Asian countries for decades. Thus, it was impossible for America to bomb Hiroshima and Nagasaki and to continue to economically colonize and rape Asian countries. It could rape and murder Vietnamese women, children, and men, then claim that Asians don't value human life. I am an Asian American woman, a mother, and a lesbian. Because these things are difficult to put into a neat package, because I am genuinely different, I know that I live in the face of this country's determination to destroy me, to negate me, to render me invisible. And the reality is that non-Asian Americans are ignorant of our existence. We share the same problems that the third world lesbian and gay men share. Because of fear of deportation, because of Asian American dependence on our families and Asian American communities for support, it's very difficult for us to be out of the closet. But we need to come out of the closet, for not to do so would be living a lie. And the great lie, which is American, can use that weakness not only to destroy Asian American lesbians and gay men, but also our third world lesbians and gay sisters and brothers. We have a right to our sexuality, to our love, and to our racial identities. This is something that sets us apart from and challenges white lesbians and gay men. We demand that you white lesbians and gay men begin to think of how you repress and oppress your Asian American lesbian and gay sisters and brothers. You share oppression from our homophobia with us, but unless you begin to address your white skin privilege and actively support Asian American lesbians and gay men, you will not have our support, and you would lose out on a chance to build the kind of world we need to live decently and lead full productive lives. You must realize the capitalist system uses not just sexual preference, but race and class as well to divide us. To our third world sisters and brothers, gay and straight, we would like to say we all share the same oppression as third world people and fear that the reason we must stand together or be hanged separately by what Audre Lorde calls, quote, the noose of conformity, unquote. To our closeted Asian American lesbians and gay men, I would like you to consider how we become accomplices to our own sexual and racial oppression when we fail to claim our true identities. I have a 3-year-old daughter, and any risk I must take to build a free future for myself and my daughter is worth it. It's concrete and as abstract as that. Thank
you. That was Michiko Cornell.
Do you support?
Speaking for the third.
Port.
Speaking for the third world gays and Asian American gays, she undoubtedly had to do with the third world National Gay Conference that took place this week in Washington at the Harambee Motel that was sponsored by the National Coalition of Black Gays, which a 5-day conference included workshops, plenary sessions, and cultural events, and included a keynote addressed by black lesbian poet Audre Lorde. We'll also be having a speaker later on concerning gay people and immigration, Tony Sullivan of Los Angeles.
I came out here on the Freedom Train from Oakland, and we made stops all across the country, and part of the national organization and the thrust of this march is bringing people out of the closet all across the country. At 2:30 in the morning, 30 lesbians and gay men met the Freedom Train in Lincoln, Nebraska. We had groups from Boston, from Salt Lake City, to meet us at 6 o'clock in the morning in Ogden, Utah. These are the people that these other people who are here live today, we're marching for them, we're demonstrating for them, as well as for ourselves. Again, you're listening to a live, the first nationally live broadcast of lesbians and gay men. And we're being carried in Denver, Colorado, Boulder, Colorado, Cincinnati, Ohio, Yellow Springs, Ohio. Lucia, Moya?
Rene McCoy, I think that people also ought to know that besides people coming from on the Freedom Train, they have also come from Texas, from Oklahoma, from Kansas City, from North Dakota, from South Dakota. They have come from the mid-Atlantic states, up and down here on the East Coast. We have people in from West Virginia and Delaware. We have people coming in from the South, from as far away as good old Dade County in Florida, and Los Angeles in Tennessee, and Kentucky.
We are individuals. usual, but yet
obviously, an event like this, with the national coordination that it involved, has set up a very strong grassroots foundation. And the organizers of the National March on Washington for Lesbians and Gay Rights have announced that the network of activists who came together to plan and carry out this march will continue to work together to plan a national meeting of lesbian and gay activists from throughout the country to discuss the direction which their newly formed organization will take. The meeting will probably be scheduled in early 1980 and will be publicized in the Lesbian, Gay, and Women's Press. So we can see that this demonstration is only the beginning of the work of a new national grassroots network in the gay community. We believe now we're about to head back to the platform. We are not about to head back to the platform.
One of the things that that we should also talk about is the lobbying constituency day, which is taking place tomorrow. Lesbians and gay men from hopefully every congressional district and every senatorial district in this country will be lobbying their congresspeople and their senators for passage of the Weiss bill, which is the gay rights bill in Congress. There's a lot of hugging and holding around here. It's a beautiful sight. There's a real family feeling here, and we hope that you're getting that feeling from this broadcast.
The tone of the people attending this demonstration has been this way all week long. It began with the Freedom Train. The people that came out here together from Oakland on that train really had a family spirit. Since I've been in Washington, I arrived Friday afternoon. Everywhere you go, it seems, you can find lesbians and gay men arriving, hugging in the streets, just a really wonderful feeling, sort of a citywide gay fair. Last night, there was a free concert here in about the same area with about 10,000 people attending, all lesbian and gay identified performers. Beautiful, beautiful spirit, and this is just really built to this moment today.
This crowd is really incredible. Again, the official police estimate is 250,000, and I believe the end of the march just got here about 10 or 15 minutes ago. The weather is generally sunny, brisk, with a little bit of a wind, but it's a beautiful day. And it would be a beautiful day even if it was raining.
I think that the variety of speakers that are speaking at this rally truly exemplifies the kind of political activism that many people across the country are showing for this march. We have organizers from like Steve Ault, who was one of our main organizers here at the National March on Washington. We have people like quite possibly the mayor of Washington City Washington D.C. is going to be showing up a little bit later on. There are feminist theorists who are coming in, like Charlotte Bunch, Ed Cruikshanks, who is of the Rainbow Alliance, a group for gay deaf mutes, is going to be having his words translated to us here on the air. Allen Ginsberg is scheduled to be coming in. It truly represents a wide spectrum of the cultural and political alliances that are forming across the country.
I think probably one of the reasons that the speakers list seems to be so disorganized for us is that while people have been here in Los Angeles, new facets of the community, in Washington, forgot where I was there for a minute. All different facets of the gay community have made themselves known. I happen to recognize the person on the stage speaking right now is Rene McCoy, a black lesbian from New York. And I'm sure that the outgrowth of the Third World Conference and all the other activities that have gone on this week have inspired more people to be included on the speaker's list.
Why don't we go back up to the stage and pick up with the rally?
Not anymore. Not anymore.
but not anymore.
Let's hear it.
Not anymore. Our very silence made us weak, but not anymore.
Not anymore.
We will not stand by silently while others struggle to be free. We will no longer bow to hate. Not anymore.
Once again, we're at the National March on Washington for Lesbians and Gay Men. We're leaving our platform right now to go back out to our mobile unit with Amy Sands and David Winyard.
CJ.
And you're?
Bovine.
Bovine.
Oh, you have...
No, it sounds too raspy. I think we better go, because otherwise it won't be clear.
We seem to be having a problem with our mobile unit right now. But with me here at the broadcast table, I have Bill Blish, who works with WPFW here in Washington, D.C., who covered the Third World Conference. Bill, why don't you tell us something about that conference?
The Third World Conference had about 500 participants from Third World countries and blacks from all over the country. They had 40 states represented. And it was a very exciting conference in the sense that there were issues that concern third world gays, such as sexism, discrimination, racism, ageism, and classism.
Are the problems of third world gays different from those of the rest of the gays, non-third world gay people?
Being third world, they have very different concerns in that they have the discrimination that normally comes when you're black or when you're Hispanic or Native American Indian. And so they thought they would address these problems from that perspective.
Did the conference deal very much with the problems of homophobia in some of the third world and minority communities in this country?
Yes, homophobia was discussed, and also issues such as concern with how we view ourselves as third world gays.
I noticed that one of the workshops, I believe, was entitled Gay People and the Family, and Gay People as Family Members in the Third World Community. Did you get to attend that one?
Yes, they had an excellent speaker, Audre Lorde, who has written several books on the matter, and they discussed the matter of parenthood, because there are many gays that do have children. Whether that was done when they were heterosexual or whatever, there are many families, as you saw even today, who have families with them, gays that have families and have children.
Another one of the issues that was discussed, I believe, was third world gays and religious issues. Can you tell us something about that workshop?
Yes. That's a very great concern to many blacks, because for the black people and for many third world people, the church is the central focal point of the community. And so it has to be dealt with when you start talking about homosexuals.
Okay, thank you very much, Bill, for talking to us. That was Bill Blish from WPFW talking about the Third World Conference of Lesbians and Gay Men. And now we're going to try to go back to our mobile unit with Amy Sands and David Wynyard.
Oh, hold on. Everyone gets into the act here. It's...
We're on. Go.
All right. Amy Sands and David Wynyard out here in the field for Pacifica Radio. We're talking to Steve and CJ from Iowa. This may be a little insulting, but are there really gay people in Iowa?
All kinds of them.
How did you all get down here for this march?
Steve, didn't we rent... we had three RVs. We rented them from Cedar Rapids.
RVs? That must have been a lot of fun coming down here.
Well, it was, but it's kind of crowded.
Kind of crowded. Well, that could be fun, too.
Well, it was okay. We had tons of beer.
I see. Is this a coming-out experience for you?
No, I've been out since age 12, and I'm 18 now.
How does it make you feel to be in such a huge crowd of gay people?
I don't know. I can't find words to describe it. I mean, that sounds tacky, but I just can't. It's different, okay?
And you, Steve?
I find it, it's really amazing. It's kind of like the Woodstock of the gay movement.
Okay, and now back to the Pacifica tent with Greg, Moira, and Lucia.
Thank you, David and Amy. Again, this is a national live radio broadcast. Some of the other stations that are picking this up, Washington, D.C., Los Angeles, California, San Francisco, California, and because of a time difference on a tape delay basis, but it may as well be live, in Anchorage, Alaska, and Juneau, Alaska. Coming up, we think, is Arly Scott from the National Organization for Women.
But once again, we are not sure. The speakers list, we don't have an exact schedule of speakers, although we have some kind of idea who's going to be speaking. As you've noticed, if you've been listening to us, we've misintroduced a couple of people because we were told somebody was about to speak and then somebody else turned up. So it's never a dull moment here. We're always in suspense.
Robin Tyler is on the platform now, and I think she's about to introduce whoever is going to come up next, and let's go with her and find out.
Back here with a million people and make sure they include us in that monument. I have here a telegram from Joan Baez. Whenever somebody mentions a march or a demonstration for gay rights, I think of Harvey Milk. His voice was always so cheerful, so full of love and joy, and he had a smile that never stopped. Spirit such as Harvey's is so vital to any movement, to know that any movement for social change must be based on love, and that anger and violence only produce anger and violence, but never produce change. So keep the spirit of love alive, because that is why you are here today. Love, Joan Baez. And she is right. We are not coming from the love of power. We are coming from the power of love, and love can never lose, never. Our next speaker is a woman I have known for many years. She is a great organizer. She has spent a decade committed to the lesbian and gay rights and feminist causes. I am honored to be a friend of this person, the vice president of the National Organization for Women, a lesbian and a sister, Arly Scott.
Which one? I can't speak it.
Well, look at us. Look at us. 250,000 in the daylight. In Washington, D.C., no famines, no pestilence, no earthquakes, no floods. Oh, eat your heart out, Anita Bryant. Look at us. Look at us, America. You know us. You see us in your offices. You see us in your schools, in your churches, in your government, in your Congress, and I dare say in your White House, America. You know us, America. We are some of your best friends. We're some of your best relatives. Your sisters, your brothers, your mothers, your fathers, your daughters, and your sons. You know us, America. We have walked with you in Memphis. We have marched with you in Selma. We have marched with you and run with you in Boston. We have been clubbed with you in Chicago and jailed with you in Birmingham and Three Mile Island. You know us, America. We have fought for civil rights movements. We have fought in the peace movement. We fought in the nuclear movement. And America, America, 10 years ago, we started to face our own oppression. We started to face our own fears. And we asked then for understanding, for justice, for equity. Listen, America, we're not asking anymore. We're 20 million strong in this country. Listen, America. Listen, America, in the 80s, we are moving from gay pride to gay politics. Gay politics. Listen, America, no longer the violence against gays and lesbians. And it is not only our enemies, it is not the strength of our enemies, it has also been the silence of our friends. No more, America. No more, America. In the 80s, listen, Mr. Ms. Politician. Listen, Mr. Presidential Candidate. Listen to us. We are 20 million strong. We are going to get organized. We are going to be unified. And we are going to go from a lesbian and gay movement to a political force in this country. Listen, America. Listen to us now. Listen. Listen, America. We're going to force you to live up to your rhetoric. We're going to force you to live up to your American dream, which at its most exalted is a spiritual and humanistic vision of our possibilities, of all of our possibilities. And it is that part, America, it is that part of the American dream that we are reclaiming today. We are 20 million strong, and into the 80s, we're not going to ask anymore. We are demanding, listen, America, you are going to have to deal with us in the 80s, America. It's really hard for a dyke to stand here and look at the Washington Monument. You see, you must understand, Anita Bryant is not against homosexuality. She's against all sex with men. Well, doesn't have to worry about me. However, Anita just quit the church she was going to because the choir insisted on singing Go Down Moses. I am very honored to present our next two guests. Marie Diaz is a special assistant to Mayor Marion Barry of Washington, D.C. Now you may ask, who is Mayor Marion Barry of Washington, D.C.? Because just being a mayor is not enough to impress us, is it? I'll tell you who Mayor Marion Barry is. He is the first mayor in the history of the United States to declare this week Gay and Lesbian Awareness Week. That's who he is. national office for the March on Washington, and let's face it, to pull this march off, these people have worked so hard. How about a terrific round of applause for the National March on Washington Committee? Representing Mayor Marion Barry Maria Diaz and representing the National March on Washington, the co-coordinator from New York, Steve-O.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here representing Mayor Marion Barry. Let me just take one moment to say what it means to represent the mayor. I serve as a special assistant to him, and oftentimes when I'm sent to represent him, some of the people who are a little bit disappointed saying, we wanted the mayor, not his representative. Let me just call your attention to the fact that there are so many demands on his time. He's currently receiving invitations for personal appearances at a rate exceeding 1,000 per month. Even if he worked 7 days a week, which he does, and tried to make all of these commitments, he'd have to do approximately 34 personal appearances a day just to meet the demand. What the mayor has done is to set up a cadre of people who represent him at engagements like this rally and other events that are important to him. He asked that the participants in the rally understand this and accept his representatives as him and accept me as his representative and not be disappointed because he could not physically be here himself. Marion Barry has long been, for those of you in Washington who know him, those of you around the country I'm sure remember him from his militant activist days with the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. He's no stranger to human rights, and we in the district do not distinguish gay rights from human rights. We have established model legislation, which we hope that the rest of the country will take a serious look at and follow our lead. We have a new director in the Office of Human Rights. We have made a conscious effort to make sure that lesbians and gays are appointed to boards and commissions in the District of Columbia. The mayor has appointed me as the liaison to the gay community in the mayor's office. We have provided funding for the Whitman Walker Clinic, which is a clinic that provides service to the gay population in the district. For the past 2 or 3 years, we have included funding for the clinic in our budget, and Congress has cut it out. This year, Congress cut it out again. We were able to find a way, though, in spite of this, to fund the clinic. We have also, for the first time, provided a gay representative to the Police Chief's Citizen Advisory Council. The District of Columbia is serious about human rights, is serious about gay rights, is serious about all of the citizens of the district. We hope that other parts of the nation will follow our lead and seek to end discrimination, whether that discrimination is in the form of racism, sexism, ageism, sexual orientationism, and any of those negative isms that create and perpetuate discrimination. They must be eliminated. Let me read to you now the proclamation. It says, the District of Columbia, Washington, D.C., Gay Rights Awareness Week, October 10th through 17th, 1979, by the Mayor of the District of Columbia, a proclamation. Whereas on October 14th, 1979, national, regional, and local affiliations of gay rights organizations will come together and unite their efforts in a national march on Washington to focus public attention on the social, economic, judicial, and legal oppression of lesbian and gay people. And whereas during this day and throughout this week, many activities, including conferences, workshops, speakers, forums, and entertainment will be provided for the purpose of establishing a communication network to reach third world lesbians and gays and to protest discrimination against lesbian and gay people. And whereas lesbians and gays prescribe to the principles of basic human rights, equality of law, and a right to happiness and prosperity for all people, regardless of their sexual orientation, and because lesbians and gays have taken upon themselves to participate in a national march on Washington to end all social, economic, and judicial oppression against them, they are exercising a right to make their concerns known. And whereas it is fitting that lesbians and gays bring their concerns to the attention of the nation's capital, and by articulating the oppression experienced by lesbians and gays, the nation will become more aware of the issues that concern them and the hardships they face in a world beyond their own. And through articulating their views, lesbians and gays have become a magnetic force in unveiling the social oppression that forestalls their human rights. Now, therefore, I, the Mayor of the District of Columbia, do hereby proclaim the week of October 10th through 17th as Gay Rights Awareness Week in Washington, D.C., and call upon all of our residents to join with me in commemorating this as a time in which to rededicate ourselves to the concept of equality for all people in our society in order to strengthen our practice of democracy. Marion Barry, Jr., Mayor, District of Columbia.
That's Marie Diaz representing Mayor Marion Barry of Washington, D.C., and he was one of the first public officials to urge lesbians and gay men to come to Washington, D.C. for this march. Steve Alt, the national co-coordinator, is coming up now. Let's go back to the stage.
Gay rights. We thank you very, very much. 10 years ago, on a sultry summer night in New York City, gay people fought back for the first time. We proclaimed to the world that the centuries-old tradition of bigotry and persecution to which we had passively submitted would no longer be tolerated. That message has reverberated everywhere. In 10 short years, a worldwide movement was born. Thousands of organizations of every conceivable variety have sprung up, and our issues and struggles make front-page news. The National March on Washington for Lesbian and Gay Rights is a milestone in our fight for freedom. For today, for the first time, we have all come together. The work of organizing this great event has itself had a profound effect upon the course of our struggle. New state coalitions have formed where none had previously existed. Local organizing has sparked new issues and grassroots participation of people in many areas, such as Vermont and Alaska. But most important, we have developed a national network. No longer will we be picked off city by city and person by person. This march has given us the capacity to respond decisively to oppression wherever it may arise. Today, we should take stock of our first 10 years and plan for the future. It is not easy to liberate oneself from the internalization of oppression wrought by eons of humiliation, degradation, and persecution that we and our ancestors have suffered. Therefore, it was necessary to separate ourselves from the rest of society and collectively raise our consciousnesses. What we see here today is proof that we have liberated ourselves from our own worst enemy, self-hatred. Now we must reach out to gain the support of progressive people to our cause. The numerous endorsements this march has received from labor unions, women's, third world, religious, and movement groups demonstrates that we are getting this most needed support. At the same time, we must also actively support the struggles of other oppressed people. In this period of social upheaval and economic collapse, The ruling powers must rely on scapegoating to preserve their control. They must pit one minority against another to distract people from the real issues. As we organize, so do our enemies. As we speak here, Anita Bryant is speaking a short distance away. But Anita is just part of a mounting, coordinated attack from the right directed against women, third world and working people, and lesbians and gay males. Now is the time to unite against the right. Their power is too great for us to go it alone. We must unite for our mutual survival, for inevitably we shall be defeated in isolation or be victorious in unity. And as we are thrust into a new decade of turmoil, the lessons of the early phase of the lesbian and gay liberation movement must not be forgotten. Let us learn from our oppression. Let us not forget what it is like to be treated as a subhuman so that we may understand the oppression of others. Let us not crave acceptance from a degenerate society. Let us not create parallel institutions which are little more than carbon copies of the same institutions which have been used to oppress us. If the great American pie is rotten, don't eat of it. Throw it out and make a new one. In 10 short years, we have come so far. Today, we are celebrating what we are. We have learned to like ourselves, and there is no greater achievement. Tomorrow, as we disperse and return to our homes, we must dedicate ourselves to the crisis of our time and to the fight for the rights and well-being of all people. Thank you very much.
Steve Walt, one of the original organizers of the National March on Washington. If you would like to become part of that national network that he was talking about, you can write to the national headquarters at 943 9th Street in Northwest Washington, 20009. And now we are going to go to our remotes with David Winyard and Amy Sands.
Hi, this is Amy Sands with David Winyard. We're out in the field talking to Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn, what did you think about, first of all, where are you from?
I'm from New York.
Are you from New York? What did you think about the Asian American woman who gave a speech about white skin privilege?
Yeah, I was delighted to hear her make the comments that she made. Some of the things that she was pointing out about the lack of consciousness around the interrelatedness between oppressions are problems that I have with not just this demonstration, but with the movement. And I think, I mean, to me it's obvious that white skin privilege is something if we don't confront, if we don't talk about racism, we can't really look at what homophobia and sexism means.
Can you explain that one a little bit more?
Well, I see them all as coming from basically the same place. And I think that this is a type of system that breeds those three types of oppression. I find for basically this movement, the demonstration today, there is a lack of consciousness about what that means.
Yeah, how do you feel in this crowd?
Well, I was standing by a group of white people holding the Lesbians Against the Nazi and the Klan sign. And when the Asian woman started to speak about that, they were stunned. They didn't know what to do. They didn't clap. They seemed to be insulted. They don't seem to realize that they have white people have a responsibility to all struggles against oppression. I mean, it's the same thing. We are all oppressed. They really don't see that.
Thanks very much. This is Amy Sands with David Winyard, and now back to the Pacifica tent.